we've been in this series of messages on in Acts, and it brings up a really important question, which is, can people change? That's a really basic question. Is it possible for people to change? And we were talking about the anniversary. You know, I mean, for, I don't know, 45 years, Eileen's been waiting for me to change. Yeah, that's not going to happen. But the thing is, what we see in Acts, and we're going to see it as it unfolds for us, is how the Holy Spirit actually propels us into change, and that we actually become different people as the Holy Spirit is alive and working in our life. Last week, Chris brought the message from Acts 3 about this healing where Peter and John on the way to worship, and they're stopped by a beggar who's been crippled for 40 years, and they, in the name of Jesus, bring him to his feet, and he goes into worship with them, you know, which is pretty outstanding. Now, the weird thing is that he hadn't been in church for 40 years, so he wasn't church broke, so he didn't know how to act. So, you know, he takes them in, they take him in, and then all of a sudden he's jumping and leaping and yelling and praying, you know, all that stuff. And it's just very embarrassing for Peter and John. And I thought, boy, that's why we don't bring friends to church, you know, right there, because they don't know how to act. And But it's such a weird phenomenon where you go, well, he's really misbehaving, and don't you wish he'd quiet down? But everybody was astounded. Now, you get to chapter 4, and Peter and John are talking to the people. It says, while Peter and John were addressing the people, the priests, the chief of the temple police, some Sadducees came up indignant that these upstart apostles were instructing the people and proclaiming that the resurrection from the dead had taken place in Jesus. They arrested them. They threw them in jail until morning, for by now it was late in the evening. But many of those who listened had already believed the message, in round numbers about 5,000. The next day, a meeting was called in Jerusalem. The rulers, the religious leaders, the religion scholars, Annas, the chief priest, John Alexander, everybody who was anybody was there. They stood Peter and John in the middle of the room and grilled them. Who put you in charge here? What business do you have doing this? And with that, Peter, full of the Holy Spirit, let loose, rulers and leaders of the people, if we've been brought to trial today for helping a sick man, put under investigation regarding this healing, then I'll be completely frank with you. We have nothing to hide. By the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the one you killed on a cross, the one God raised from the dead, by means of his name, this man stands before you healthy and whole. Jesus is the stone you masons threw out, which is now the cornerstone. Salvation comes no other way. No other name has been or will be given to us by which we can be saved. Only this one. They couldn't take their eyes off him. Peter and John standing there so confident, so sure of themselves. Their fascination deepened when they realized that these two were laymen with no training in scripture, no formal education, but they recognized them as having been with Jesus. And with the man right before them, seeing him standing there so upright, so healed, what could they say against that? They sent them out of the room so they could work out a plan. Pray with me. Lord, teach us. Teach us from your word. Teach us from how you work in our lives. And we sometimes don't even see it, but help us to see it today. We pray for your Holy Spirit to enliven us and turn us into the bold people that you made us to be. That's our need today, in Jesus' name, amen. So, I love this passage. This is one of my favorite passages in the whole Bible. I love it. Because, for one, we're talking about, can people change? Here you have Peter, who, not that long ago, the night of Jesus' arrest, was denying him, and the people said, "You're one of his followers, aren't you?" And he's saying, "No, no, not me. I don't know anything. You know, leave me out of this. I don't know Jesus." And now he's changed dramatically with a boldness, confidence, a surety that can only be explained by the unleashing of the Holy Spirit in him. It's not that he went to a self-help program and figured out how to speak better or how to appear more confidently. That didn't work. This was the Holy Spirit speaking through him and giving him a confidence, a boldness. And a boldness in the New Testament Greek, it means something like a sanctified stubbornness. You know, you're so sure, you're so certain that you don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be hesitant. And of course, the evidence of the guy who was so ill-behaved in worship, it's hard to argue. It's hard to argue with their experience, what happened. So when I look at this, I see this movement from Acts 1, where Jesus meets with the disciple one last time, and they don't get it, they don't know anything, and he says, you know, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, something's going to change. What is it? You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. You will be my witnesses when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And now we're seeing it here in Acts 4, beginning to be lived out, this boldness, this sharing. And we've talked about what it means to be a witness. The word's also the word for martyr, so it means to lay down your life, and we've always thought of martyrs, you know, as being, you get killed, right? You know, you live. But actually, it also means to lay down your life means to open yourself up, to share your life. That's witnessing. So when people come to you with their important life questions, you don't have to answer their questions. You just share, how has Jesus met you? Where have you seen God working in your life? How has the Holy Spirit set you free? Where do you need Jesus to work today? All those issues is being a witness. It's laying down your life. And and if that is what witnessing is, and it's what we're seeing here in chapter 4, this passage of when they were confused because Peter and John were just ordinary people. They weren't supposed to talk like this. They weren't supposed to share so confidently. They were supposed to be intimidated. The religious bully factor was there, and they didn't seem in awe of it or intimidated. Rather, they just proclaimed. You want to know what's happening? Here's what's happening. It's Jesus, the one you rejected. Well, you Masons threw out the wrong rock, because Jesus was the cornerstone. This whole thing is built on him. You missed it. And it says that when they saw that they were ordinary people, they were uneducated, they were untrained, they didn't understand that. It didn't make sense. And then they noticed one other thing. They'd been with Jesus. They realized they'd been with Jesus. And that was the part they couldn't figure out. What is happening here? This verse, just to let you know, over the years, I've tried to grapple with this verse and that meaning. What does it mean to be ordinary people who have been with Jesus? And that is what this ministry is about. That's what unleashing people is about. Now, I'm a highly overeducated pastor, you know. If we were in a big church with the robes, I'd get the doctoral stripes and, you know, and pompous and everything, and I'd be able to look down on everybody, you know, and I'd be the smartest guy in the room, you know, and you'd all have to respect me. But this verse says that what Jesus is doing and what the Holy Spirit is doing is not about that. For hundreds of years, we clergy have gotten it wrong, thinking that we're special. What this is saying is, no, Jesus is doing a new thing, and with the Holy Spirit, he's taking regular people, no special training, no special unique abilities and years of working at it. No, you know, not doing the 10,000 hours that you have to do, you know, to get your proficiency, like the Beatles in Germany. You know, we read that book a little bit, and you don't have to do that. The Holy Spirit's going to change us. And that credibility is going to come from the boldness of the Spirit, not from doctrine stripes on your arm. I was accused once, I was accused of trying to do away with the, clergy. I said, no, I'm not. I'm trying to do away with the laity. There's no such thing as a layperson anymore. We're all ministers, you know? We're a room of ministers. That's what it is. Pastor Barron, you know. I always wanted to throw that out. Pastor Mary, you know. But you think about that, you go, this is what Jesus is doing. This is how the Holy Spirit works in us. And every one of us is called to ministry, right? And people are going to be shocked because they're going to, why are you sharing? Couldn't you get the pastor to come over and maybe join us at the table and talk to us about these things? What a stupid idea that is. I've been a pastor way too long, but there have been people, you know, who invite me to play golf with them because they're going to have somebody from their company there who needs to meet Jesus. So if we have the pastor come and join the golf group, you know, and then they're nervous when they find out because they realize that they've been swearing for 15 holes and now they're really humiliated because they've been swearing not knowing that I was the pastor. And now we're supposed to go into the clubhouse, have some adult beverage, and I'm supposed to lead them to Jesus. Well, forget it. Why don't you just do it? Play your own game, you know. I've had people actually make appointments over the years, and they bring someone, a family member, something who really needs Jesus. And they want to bring them there, and I don't know what's going on, and pretty soon you figure it out. Oh, they want me to save them. Well, guess what? Nobody's been saved by me. It's always Jesus, isn't it? And all they would have to do is lay down their lives for their friend or their family member, open up their own heart and share. And it'll be far more powerful than anything that the trained professional might say. Because people are shocked when they hear regular people talking about what the Lord's doing or could do or might do or has done. They're shocked by that. Do you know how many people are shocked when I talk about what the Lord can do? Zero. Absolutely no one. Because they go, well, you're trained to do that. You're like the monkey with the cup and the, you know. That's just wrong. Yeah. You know? But it's stunning when someone hears a regular person saying, well, you know, I'll tell you what, I'm going through this right now, and I really need the Lord here. In fact, then ask your pagan friend, do this. This is a good one. Would you pray for me this week? Would you pray for me that, you know, the Lord could meet me in this way? And they're going, well, no, I'm your pagan friend. What are you talking about? No, I need you to pray. I need you to be a minister to me. And they go, oh. Well, okay, guess I will, I could, you know. Why don't we have our pagan friends praying for us? Why not? Maybe that's the new evangelism. Wouldn't that be great? Or ask them for advice. You know, could you help me see how God works in this situation? You know? And they go, really? Yeah, in fact, would you look up in the Bible this week? Let's meet next week. But you, meanwhile, why don't you research in the Bible and see what you can come up, see if there's some things in there that could be helpful to me. That's so much better than inviting them to a Bible study. Because now they're going to have to read the whole doggone thing just to find something to help you with. I don't know. It just has struck me that the people were in awe because they couldn't figure out why ordinary, untrained, unschooled people were so bold. Then they realized that they'd been with Jesus. That's all we need. When people realize we've been with Jesus, no wonder we've changed. No wonder we can change. No wonder there's hope. What would it be like if we, like Peter and John, if we just kind of went into our week, wherever we're going, whatever we're doing, and we go there as if God, the Holy Spirit, has commissioned you as a minister in that place. Maybe it's a meeting you have to go to, a planning meeting or something, or a conference call on the phone, and you're there, and you know, Lord, I'm going in as your representative here. So tell me what to say. Help me to hear differently. You know, whatever. It would be so strange. I was thinking this weekend we're honoring here in Seattle. We're honoring Ken Griffey Jr. Remember, and he got into the Hall of Fame. And is he the first Mariner to be in the Hall of Fame? The only? Wow. I've got a first year Ken Griffey baseball card in my office. I'm not telling you which shelf it's on because you know it's the only thing I have of value. It's really neat to hear these tributes and everything like that, but it got me thinking about 2 years before Ken Griffey Jr. came to the Mariners. Any of you guys alive back then? I'm the oldest guy in the room. You know, Ken Behring was the owner of the. Was it Ken Behring?
No,
he owned the Seahawks, right? Okay, anyway, I don't know who the name of the owner was, but there was a headline in the PI. Do we still have a PI?
Barry Ackerley.
Thank you. So the PI, which means post-intelligence, which means after intelligence is gone, then you read it. That's a whole other deal. But the thing is, there was a headline on the sports page, and I think I wrote about this in one of the early books, but I don't know. But it was Mariners Fire God. It was really fun, and that got my attention. And it turned out the Mariners were losing. They always lost, you know. They just lost always. And so the owner decided that the reason the Mariners were losing was because there were too many Christians on the team. This the PI, you know, and so there's too many Christians. So he banned team Bible studies. He banned team chapel services. He banned any talking about the Lord in the locker room. That's off limits. We're going to be competitive. We're going to be tough. We're going to be winners.
That didn't work.
No, they still lost. But and he's really going to take a stand because all these Christians are just making the team soft. That was the philosophy. So. The reporter called up, who was the Seahawk guy who caught all the... Steve Largent. Yeah, he was now he'd left and had gone to be a congressman, I think, in Oklahoma or something. And they called Steve Largent and said, what do you think of this? You know, you're a Christian, you're a football player, you were competitive, you know, what do you think of this? And Steve Largent said, I'll never forget this. Oh, it makes perfect sense. The Mariners always get rid of their best players. If someone's doing really, really good and helping the team, they trade them away. So let's get God out of here now, too. I thought, oh, man, that's so great. But here's what happened, and this is the point I want to make. The head of the church council for the city of Seattle was asked about it and said, I support management's decision in this. Oh, the report went, you do? Yes. Why should a player bring their faith into the locker room? You wouldn't expect a banker to bring their faith with them into the bank. You wouldn't expect a nurse to bring their faith into the hospital. I'm going, wow, I would actually. I would love to have a banker praying over my checkbook. Yeah. You know? But it was funny though, and I think if we got the idea that we bring the Lord with us wherever we go, or even more, that the Lord's there ahead of us at the meeting waiting for us to come in. It changes how we relate to people. It changes how we listen. It changes how we share, because we're expecting the Holy Spirit to be present, the living Lord Jesus to never leave us or forsake us, remember, to be present, to helping us in our decisions, in our conversations, in our caring. People are going to be in awe. They're going to be stunned by that, because they're not used to it. This is just ordinary people. I think that God's plan was that ordinary people are how the kingdom's going to be built. Why? Because when God uses you and me in some way, some healing way, some helpful way, some encouraging way, some prayerful way, whenever God uses one of us, everybody around can go, wow, that must have been the Lord, because they sure couldn't have done that. Mm-hmm. Right? It had to have been the Lord. Why would they do that? And God gets credit, because we're living so far beyond ourselves. So far beyond. Now, yesterday I was visiting Damien. He's in a hospital down by the airport, and we were talking, and he said that one of the things that he's noticed is that, and he's struggling with, but he's trying to accept, is that the only way to win in an addiction issue is by defeat. Nobody wins unless they admit defeat. There's no victory in an addiction unless you surrender. And I thought about that, and I thought, well, maybe that's why the church over the years has had such a trouble experiencing a victory in Christ. Because we think that if we just think about it a little more, if we just plan a little better, if we just get ourselves going, if we get the right strategy, where maybe the victory comes when we wave the white flag and say, I surrender. I need the Lord. And when we say that, it changes everything. But one of the things we found, I've read more about AA than I ever thought I would. But the most difficult thing for any addict to do is the first step, to admit they're powerless. And I think that's the most difficult thing for us as Christians too. For us to admit that we're powerless And without the Holy Spirit filling us, encouraging us, teaching us, leading us, helping us to will something, you know, his purposes, without guiding us, protect, without that, there is no victory. Now, I struggle with that because I go, I should be able to live the Christian life on my own. I'm motivated, I'm smart, I can do stuff, not much, but some stuff. Why can't I live the Christian life without the Holy Spirit? Because it was never meant to be that way.